Good. Yes, we start with the first speaker, who is already a capacity in UHPC. In the UHPC world, we can say Peter Beutelaar. He has 37 years of technical, commercial and practical experience in ultra-high performance concrete in the business areas wear protection, offshore and civil engineering. And he worked during the first years for two Dutch contractors and later for two Danish, actually Danish producers and suppliers of dry mixed UHPC products. Peter Beutelaar has a consulting company here in the Netherlands, based in Amsterdam, which he started in 2013. So welcome, Peter.
Thank you.
The floor is yours.
Good afternoon. I put firstly a short history, because usually I'm talking for 2 or 4 hours, so I only have a limited time of 30 minutes, so I will not tell too much. But it's very important, my Chinese colleague, taking knowledge from the past for new developments and better creations. I think that's very important. In our industry, in the construction industry, we are not using a lot of information and references from what is in the past. Every time we are trying to invent the wheel again. Very short, what many people don't know, but UHPC is original developed by Aalborg Portland in 1978 by Hans Hendrik Bagger. He made already in the 60s a lot of theories about how to compress cement particles and how to get a denser packing. The problem is that between cement particles, you have what they call attractive forces. And for that reason, you can pack them dense to each other. After the development of superplasticizers, it was made possible to overcome these attractive forces at the surface and make a more denser packing of the cement particles. But even when you pack cement as dense as possible, related to the form from the cement, there are still a lot of pores which you in principle can fill. Of course, when you fill these pores, you are reducing the water binding ratio. Because what you fill, there is simply no water. It also means that you get less volume of your mix compared to a traditional cement mix. So you have to use much more cement particles or much finer particles in combination. After the first test that he made, he came in contact with a Norwegian colleague where they had a lot of microsilica, almost for free because it was a waste product. So he started to use this because his experiments with very fine cement didn't work. When you make cement very fine, you get fast reactions and you cannot control it anymore. But microsilica is less reactive than the cement. It starts to react later. So by five, the other good thing is for microsilica that the particles are round, while your cement particles are shaped. So you can make an optimum packing between the cement particles with microsilica. After his first test, with adding more than 30% ultrafine particles, in this case microsilica, he reached a compressor strength of more than 280 megapascal with the water binding ratio of 0.18, 0.25, which is of course very strong. This is also in contrary what we learned in concrete technology, because we are talking about that the plasticizer is reducing the water amount and therefore you get a better workability, but it's a side effect. The real effect is that you can pack it dense, and because you pack it dense, there is simply less space for mixing water. And the round particles are helping as a, let's say, a ball bearing to make a certain flow in the material. So it is time that we are changing some books. Some properties of the material, which is in general, which doesn't mean that it is for each material like this. It is a very dense microstructure. You talk about 70% to 90% of the maximum density what you can reach, which means it is as dense as glass or plastic. You can even make it more denser by filling the pores between the round microsilica particles or other alternative materials with much more fine material. So you can go to maybe 95% of the maximum density. A very fast strength development. Usually at 20 degrees, you reach in 24 hours 40% to 50% from the final strength. Then we are talking about 90 to 150 megapascal in 24 hours, which means that you can take it out of the formwork, you can use a floor, you can do a lot of things. Of course, when you have very strong materials, they are extremely brittle. Think about steel, very hard steel. When you throw a tool on the floor, it will break in parts. So you have to do something about this brittleness of the material by using fibers, aggregates, and reinforcement to make it ductile. A very dense microstructure gives a much better grip on aggregates, but also on very small fibers, because there is much larger surface contact area. So you get, in general, a bonding which is 4 to 5 times higher than what you can reach in a normal concrete. So we are using the steel in a much better and efficient way than in a traditional concrete. Also, the material is having a very high impact strength and wear resistant, especially when you're using special aggregates and fiber cocktails. Like what I said, the material is extremely brittle. So when you only use the binder with fine sand, this was the result of Bagger found on his desk the next day. It was cracked by itself because it is extremely brittle. You get some shrinkage, and you get a crack. Also, the video, let's see if he's... This is only reinforced, so you see a very...
Sir.
You did it wrong. He was already there.
Was he playing?
Yeah, I was playing.
Sorry.
So it's very, very brittle. For that reason, now in test institutes, they are using a special plastic cover around it because it will splash in all the directions with a very loud sound. So you have to reinforce the material to make it more ductile. The diffusion coefficient is extremely low compared to a traditional concrete. It's also having a very high electrical resistivity, which is good for concrete repair and protection of the rebars. It is absolutely frost resistant, even in combination with de-icing salts, and this test is done with temperatures of -40, -50. Chemical resistance is good or even very good, depends on the material what you use, and the only reason is the material is so dense that acids cannot penetrate the material itself and destroy it from inside. So it is always superficial, which means you can make also repair if necessary. Underwater and in water, it is having a very low permeability. You talk about less than 1 millimeter, so it's extremely dense. The very high wear resistance is important for some applications, and in that case, you're using very hard wear-resistant materials like calcite bauxite, corundum, silicon carbide. So a UHPC, in general, is not automatically very wear-resistant. You need aggregates for that. Already in that time, the problem is in that time we were not so advanced as today, so it is not in all the computers and on the World Wide Web, but a lot of publications were written. Bagger presented it first time, his concept, in 1981. Of course, the reason was that he applied for a patent, so he didn't came too early. And a lot of international tests are done in that time. In 1986, because of the brittleness, he developed a material what is called compact reinforced composite, or CRC. So he used the ultra-high strength mortar with an amount of more than 400-500 kilogram steel fibers, very small, very strong, and with up to 20 volume percent of traditional reinforcement or special rebars. You get then an extreme ductile material, lighter than steel, but as strong as steel, which you can form in all ways, like with the concrete. Of course, one of the first applications was military applications. Also, the CRC, a lot of this is published in the 1980s. A lot of tests are done all over the world, and the French contractor Bouygues wanted to have a license in the early 90s for this material. And that's the reason that Bouygues and Duptal were developed by Lafarge. They were working, they had a cooperation with Alcoa Portland for this material because they wanted to have a worldwide license. And then they found out that they could also do it by themselves. So they developed their own first reactive powder concrete, and later this became Duptal. Very important, of course, for this kind of materials is the what they call the brittleness. So how to think about this, which means that you reinforce actually the material around the rebars with a lot of steel fibers, so that that is very ductile, and that you get compression zones between the rebars. When you look to the properties, you can see that it is an incredible strong material. When you use it in combination with high amount of fibers and traditional reinforcement. When you use special reinforcement, like the Kevlar or special steel, you get a much stronger material because the weak link is still the steel. Now we are talking about ultra high performance concrete, but the materials already existed for a long time. And in all publications, you see that they use a lot of different names, like very high strength concrete, ultra high strength concrete. Also, when you look to the Dutch norms, we are still talking about the strength of the material. Well, we should talk much more about the properties of the material and design the material because the properties needed, not because of compressed strength. That is done, of course, because in normal concrete, the compressive strength is saying something about the density of the material. But with ultra high performance concrete, that's not important anymore. Pagostase gets recognized in the world already by a well-known professor from Canada who did some projects in Canada. And today, he's getting a lot of attention in his work in especially Asia. Already since mankind, we always try to hide and protect what we have. We put it under the ground, we put it in a pyramid, we put it somewhere hidden, and later we start to make very strong boxes and closets to keep our important things away. Of course, this had to be tested. You see that already in the 19th century, they were making fireproof tests, dropping tests, all this kind of test to test the quality of the product. Of course, this industry is very interested in a material which is extremely strong. So already since 1983, UHPC is used in what they call ATMs, safes and vaults. There are very strict tests for this all over the world, according to a class, which is based on what they call resistant units. And the resistance units are based on the kind of equipment what you are using. So how heavy the equipment is, how less resistance points you get for the safe. And the idea is to make a hole in the wall that you can enter with two hands in the safe and take out what you believe is in the safe. Of course, the material is not only stronger, but you can also make very slim constructions with it compared to normal concrete. So applications are, for instance, strong rooms built up with prefab panels. Scotland Yard made a huge safe room from two stories high, a floor surface from more than 1,000 square meters. And what they put in there are drugs what they take in customs. They are stored there. But of course, also strong rooms like in bank buildings where your people have their private things, the watches and the diamonds, like what you do with your stuff. Before you can make a safe or a wall panel, which they have in different classes and different thicknesses, you have to understand how the guys who are testing it are trying to enter. So when you know that they are using a torch, you have to use stainless steel because the stainless steel is not melting so fast like a normal soft steel. You have to create barriers by putting, for instance, hoses in it filled with steel balls. So that when they're trying to drill, the drill cannot get any grip. So there are a lot of special solutions. This is a kind of Omega profile, which you put on the back wall. So you can create compression zones. So when they take a big hammer and they start to hit on it, it is only vibrating and they don't break the concrete. So like this, you can make the most strong walls in the world. They were already tested in Holland, also in very early in 1985 by Ad Verhagen from the KMA, because he was one of the few people who was allowed to work with explosives. But also in these times, we have to protect ourselves and important buildings. And this is, for instance, what they call a blast wall, which is in the new World Trade Center in New York, placed in the parking garage under the building. So when a truck with loaded an explosive is exploding there, the damage will be minimum. Also, for instance, like around the German embassy in Kabul, they make the blast wall. While the blast walls around the American embassy were completely destroyed, nothing happened with this blast wall around the German. You can see videos on the internet, and it's quite impressive when you get an explosion like that. Another way is, because Aalborg Portland is a big cement producer, they had a lot of wear because cement is very abrasive. It's a very fine particle, sharp, especially when you at that time also are using fly ash in combination, which means that steel is like if you have a small sandpaper and you move it around all the time. And you talk about hundreds and thousands of tons of cement that is transported under pressure in a pneumatic or hydraulic system. So you get a lot of wear. They found that this material with very high particles is an excellent wear lining, working better than high-tech ceramics and special steel. And also you can make very complex forms. So this is what they call a scope feeder in the cement factory. This is crushing the clinker to make cement from it. Usually this was made in cast iron with a lifetime of 7 to 12 months. Making concrete, say it's simple, but a very strong concrete, you talk about 280, 300 megapascal. It's having a lifetime from at least 7 to 10 years without problems. Also the material you can cast in a form like in pipes, especially the bends, of course. You can make prefab panels which you place, so you have a lot of flexible possibilities to use the material. You can apply it by hand. You can shotcrete it. Here you can see that the compressor strength doesn't say anything about other properties. So it is a performance-based product what you have to make. So how hard the aggregates are, how low the compressor strength is, but how higher the wear resistance is. So it is not automatically so that when you have a high compressor strength, that you also have a very good wear resistance. That is depending on the properties of the aggregates that you're using. And actually you need a very good grip. So you also need a material with a certain shrinkage to get a very good grip on the aggregates. So that when you can wear, the material is moved in small, limited layers. And not complete particles, like in a normal concrete, not complete particles are taken out. Floors, when you talk about toppings, 1.5, 2 centimeters placed on normal concrete, where you have heavy wear and tear. In the heavy industry, the first jobs we made was in Belgium, in 86 for Caterpillar production for machines like this. Very big, very, very big areas where they tested the machines. So they do everything what is actually forbidden on the floor. They do. And they withstand this. These are floors with a compressor strength of 200 megapascal. Food industry, because they have a lot of hygienic rules, and everybody who's working in the food industry knows that when it is wet and temperatures, all the nice epoxies and other materials are not working. You need something cement-based and very strong, because the guys who are working there are not very, very careful. Also for that, for floors, you can make a lot of different products with strengths up till 200 megapascal, which you can place in different ways. Another product, which is originally developed in France, what they call Salviazine, which means that you have open asphalt. So the open asphalt is not developed for rain, like what we use it for in Holland, but it was originally developed to fill with cement, so that you get a material which can accept some compression and is still flexible compared to a concrete pavement. So you make a special slurry, and with the original system, you need vibrators to vibrate it in. But with the UHPC slurry, it is running it by itself, and it is of course having a much better durability compared to a traditional grout. You can apply this material on concrete, like in a renovation, in the steelworks for instance, because you can also apply it very fast and use it very fast, but also on asphalt, like with bus stops, you see it a lot. Belgium, I made the auction hall for fish, Zeebrugge, very, very large floors with this. You can make it different thicknesses. Warehouses, traffic lanes, terminals, bus terminals, container handling. An excellent product because it is jointless. You talk about wear, one of the first applications after the invention of UHPC was the Kinsua dam in United States, where they had wear of up till 90 centimeters in the spilling basin, which is extreme. So there a special concrete was made based on the tensor technology and applied in that time. Also Venezuela, I made a lot in large dam projects where the abrasion is of course extreme. You can also shotcrete the material, so when you have to protect walls, you can use a very, very thin layer, so you don't add extra weight, but a layer of 10, 50 millimeters is already as dense as a normal shotcrete in 50, 60 millimeters. In Holland, we made in the 80s a lot of underwater repairs from what we call locks and sluices, where they had wear of 7-8 centimeter concrete per year. And by applying 2 centimeters, this stopped. Problem is that when you make a part like that, you have to take care that you do also the parts going up, not only horizontal but also vertical, because when you see underwater videos, you see that it is actually searching the weak spots in the concrete. And as soon as there is a small hole, you get more erosion there locally, and then it can still destroy the concrete structure. And as soon as you reach the lean concrete or the full concrete, what you use as a foundation, the whole thing can collapse, of course. So you have to make annual inspections. Then we had a problem with the bridge in Holland, and I said, okay, we can make a repair by casting UHPC on the water. So I made a proof of concept by myself with a big formwork, and we had a presentation like this today, but then with a lot of practical things. And then I showed the casting on the water to several engineering companies and raised the mold the next day so that they also could see how hard the material is in just 24 hours. Then Intron at that time was still existing, and Bureau de Wegen, they had a problem in Venezuela for Pacoot, which is now Vopak. There they had a jetty where they had pre-stressed foundation piles, which were cast in the centrifugal method, but they were hanging just a little bit, which means that the cover on the reinforcement was too less. So after when the jetty was finished, they had within 1 year, they had extreme corrosion because the seawater is warm and very salty. So it had to be repaired urgently, otherwise they couldn't use the jetty, and that was the only loading and unloading possibility for Pacoot. So a Dutch company placed there a very thin 30 millimeter cover around the jetty. Which means you put the formwork, you use a pump and some mixers, you pump it from under, you fill the formwork, and one day later you remove the formwork and the whole splash down zone of 6 meters is protected. After that, the oil industry, Venezuela have a large, or they had a large oil industry, and they have a lake, what they call Lake Maracaibo, where Shell started to make money, where Heerema started to make money, where they have a lot of platforms and a lot of oil. And in the lake is a kind of bacteria who is eating a lot of other materials, which means that they have a lot of corrosion problems with the steel legs and the concrete legs from the platforms. So there we did the same. We strengthening the platform and we repair it with a UHPC
as a durable protection.
Later in 71, they started to raise the Ekofisk field because the bottom under the Ekofisk field was lowering because they took a lot of oil and gas out. So in Holland, we made a special wall in a high quality concrete. And then they cut, to say it simple, the legs from the platforms and they raise it 6.5 meters and they put new steel tubes between it so that the whole platform was much higher. And this, all these legs were filled with UHPC. So we talk about more than 1,000 cubic, which was used there to fill the legs with UHPC. Because of course, when you fill the leg, it is much, much more stronger in load capacity. So since that time, offshore platforms are strengthened, repaired with UHPC. It's not only that they put it inside, but they also can place extra members to strengthen the platform when it is not strong enough anymore for the loads. Also, when tubes are crushed because of an accident, they can put a clamp around it and fill the clamp with UHPC. So there are a lot of repair possibilities, and several companies in the world are doing this on a daily basis. Then, of course, the offshore wind turbine foundations came, first starting in Denmark. And there you have the same, you place a monopile, and on that you put the rest of the structure. And the monopile is hit in the seabed. It's usually in locations where the water is not too deep. And then you place the top, and this has to be fixated and corrected because it is not always level. So then the space between the two piles you are filling with the UHPC grout. And then you get a very strong connection. In Holland, we have what I call the Royal Flora, which is close to Amsterdam in Alsmeer, which is now the fifth large building in the world with almost 1 million square meters floor surface, so it's quite big. Then they made a cold store in an area from around 10,000 square meters, which was before a parking deck, which means that the loads couldn't be too high on it. So they made a solution where they use what they call foam glass as an insulation, and on top of that they put a special asphalt layer with cement from Ladingswald. But the cars that they use to transport the flowers have very small wheels. They call them Equidanis cars. They're very small wheels from steel or hard nylon. And even when you talk about flowers, they're standing in buckets with water on very small wheels. So you have a lot of compression, of course, which means that the foam glass, which is actually like a biscuit, where you do this with two parts, it is completely deteriorating. So holes came, cars are falling, and the problem is when the cars are falling and you have water from the roses and water from the chrysanthemum, you get pollutions and bacteria and everything has to be thrown away. So people who are renting this building started to complain. So a big engineering consultant was involved in this and he made a lot of solutions, steel plates and a lot of ideas, but the maximum weight was of course limited. So they asked me to make a solution and I came with a leave everything how it is, and we apply 20 to 24 millimeter of UHPC with a very fine mesh reinforcement in it. You made some test areas. And after 1 year, the people said, well, this is the only thing that is working, so we want to have the whole floor done like this. I see it's, let's say, busy, especially when it is Mother's Day, for instance. So it's a simple reinforcement, 50 by 50, around 6. We use some nails to make a temporary fixation in the foam glass because there is nothing to hold. We weld it where we could weld it so that it could shrink without curling or peeling. And the weight was because of the maximum weight restrictions. And we made more than 10,000 square meters. And this is more than 25 years ago, and it is still working. So the people are happy because now they find out that they actually pay too less for the floor. I wrote an article about it in a Dutch journal for the concrete industry, cement. And then I was called by the Ministry of Transport in the Netherlands. And they asked me if this could also be applied on a bridge deck. And not the concrete bridge deck, but the steel bridge deck, which you call autotrophic steel bridge decks. But they have fatigue problems. It's not unique in Holland. It's all over the world for the moment. This was in 1999 that we started this project. So we started to investigate. I made the first descriptions how to do this. And we made test areas. And the most important thing was, how can you fix this concrete to a steel bridge? In Canada, there is a small trial area on the bridge where they use welded mesh, where they welded on the steel deck to keep it, but it didn't work. The normal method will be that you put shear stud connectors. But when you weld on the steel deck, you get, in theory, but also results are proving this, again, a fatigue problem. Because as soon as you weld, you already change the material properties of the steel. You create a weak point, and the welding is not always optimum. So it's, again, a potential crack. So I said, why don't we do like with a concrete floor? You make a structure to get the optimum bonding. But of course, on a steel deck, that's a little bit difficult. So we use a special epoxy. We put in very hard bauxite aggregates. That's the bonding zone. And then we put the reinforcement, because it is, we talk about hybrid reinforcement. We put the reinforcement, and that worked extremely well. We have a bonding in poor fueling from more than 5 megapascal and tensile more than 12 megapascal. That is what we would like to have in concrete, to be honest. So I made a solution, including a lot of details, because of course on the bridge you have a lot of details. You have working joints, you have final joints, you have expansion joints, how to put your reinforcement overlaps, because it's a layer from only 50 millimeter. So you have to take care. And then we start to apply it on the large bridges in the Netherlands and in Germany. So a lot of bridges are strengthened this method, and we see the oldest bridge already from 2003 and 2005, and they're still doing the job, which saves millions of the government, of course. Otherwise, I had to, because the situation was so bad that otherwise a lot of bridges had to be replaced immediately because all the repair methods didn't work anymore. Of course, you can also do this on concrete bridges. The first bridge I made was in Taiwan, where they had a problem. We did a lot of investigation, what the reinforcement is doing, etc. Also there, you get a lot of details. Then in 2003, we had a lot of viaducts in the Netherlands, the concrete bridges, where they were in as an emergency lane. They wanted to use the emergency lane as a normal road for heavy traffic. If you talk about the most right lane, which means that the viaduct had to be restrengthened also. So there we did the same. An overlay with a lot of reinforcement. I designed something with special anchors so that you can level the reinforcement very easy. And it is also working as a shear anchor. You can already see on the small circles when they're drilling the hole for the anchor, how bad the concrete is. Extremely bad. So you I have to calculate that you actually don't have any bonding. So the shear angles are very, very important in this case. You can place it with a large slip foam paper. So this machine can do a lathe from 18 meters wide and can run 40 meters per hour. So you can do very large areas in this way. Also in other countries, you see that they start to use this method a lot, because all over Europe, but also America, we have our infrastructure designed and built in the 70s and 60s, and they're deteriorating. Switzerland, of course, they have a lot of salts, cold winters, so they have a lot of trouble. So also there, they start to use this method to strengthen and to repair concrete bridges. In Europe, Switzerland is leading this for the moment. America is even worse. I've been there several times. You talk there about more than 600,000 bridges where they have serious problems. So you see there that now they have finally, after many years, a huge budget available, that almost weekly they are repairing concrete bridges in the United States with UHPC as an overlay. You can also make very, very slender structures. Like this are planks for the car bridge in the highway A44. They're only 45 millimeter thick. And this is a highway, that means that you have the highest traffic class on it. And this is replacing the original deck, because it's a school bridge, a movable bridge. The original deck was made of wood. But the problem was with wood that every time they had to put the bolts again, because wood is working more than concrete. So this shows that you can make extreme strong, slender structures, and that actually the steel what you're using is the weak link. When you are not using, let's say, traditional steel in this one, but for instance, Kevlar, you could put much, much more load on it. But even 18 ton is quite impressive on a very thin plate from 45 millimeter. But then when it breaks, you also see what is really happening. You see that the traditional reinforcement is getting fatigued and stops. You can make nice precast bridges in the modular system. So you always use the same concept. So you can make them as long as you want. Very slim, very attractive. This is already what Bagger had foreseen in 1986, because his sketches in 1986 are already explaining this. You have a lot of weight savings, because the weight savings and the strength of the material, you can make huge spans, which you cannot make in a normal concrete. They're doing this in Malaysia, already more than 150 bridges, and this is a small one. It spans from more than 100 meters. This is one for 5 meters wide, that means that one car can drive over it, not to have to drag it. But it's a single span bridge. They also make much larger one on the construction. 105 meters span and 34 meters wide. That's a highway bridge in UHPC. So you save a lot of material, which is there very important, because you can make it precast, you can transport it, and you can place it in a much easier way. Because not in those countries, you don't have mixing plants everywhere, like here. A bridge in Holland, the Catharina Bridge in Leiden, also built up with precast elements, and then the joint is cast together by using UHPC to make a strong connection. Tokyo, the airport, they have to expand the airport, and because of the bottom settlement, similar like in Holland, durability, because it's a marine environment, they selected to make very, very thin UHPC slabs on the foundation. It's an airport, it means that the biggest planes are landing on this. So minimum thickness. And it's a huge area. I've seen the construction, so it is interesting. And by you making ribs, of course, you use the material very, very efficient. The dent is placed on steel girders. The daughter from Bagge did the architect education also, but she's also a civil engineer. And already in this period, she designed what we can call giant structures made in concrete. So you talk about a stadium or a mall, very thin, very slim, made in UHPC. Facades, university in the south of Denmark. They make nice forms, very slim, so that it can hang on the existing building without too much problems. Louvre, Abu Dhabi, all the walls, elements are made with UHPC in white. So very slender compared to the normal construction methods. Made in the factory, brought to the location, and then they place it. And the complicated thing was that there were a lot of different forms and dimensions of the plate, so it was a real puzzle. Nice structure. This is like a Lego structure what they made. National Museum of Qatar, the same. Designed. Also by the same famous architect as Abu Dhabi. Design life 60 years. A lot of different elements because it has to be a desert rose. So a lot of small plates which were placed on a special construction. And of course there they have wind loads, they have extreme temperature. So it's quite complex. And you can see that the formwork is actually like a desert road. It's very beautiful to see it. Balconies, very slender balconies in different forms, original, beautiful buildings. People are sometimes complaining because they feel when they walk on the balcony that there is a kind of vibration, what is a little bit scary for them because they're used to very thick slabs of 150, 200 millimeter. A lot of different types are made as a standard solution, so it's very elegant. Stairs, of course. Architects have always funny ideas that you can spend a lot of money for. So you can make a lot of funny stairs. Looks, of course, very good in modern buildings. You save a lot of thickness, so it looks much more slender. You can make them prefab, put them in place. Different colors, different texture. This one, Sahara Deep. It's almost like a floating stair. They call it also Stairways to Heaven in this case. It's very, very beautiful. I also did a project with an artist. We did something in university in Delft in 2000. So we used big recycled glass in UHPC. And then of course when you polish it, which is very hard work for the Italians, you polish it, you see the light going through it. So we were thinking about carrying structures, like for a mosque for instance, and then you have the glass in it and you get very, very beautiful light effects. Then we made one big seat and it was used for an auction hall for a hospital for cancer patients, for kids. The money. Also very slender. It's less than 20 millimeters, so it's, you can walk on it. This was for me short, but I know that it's too long. As long as nobody complains, I continue.
Okay.
Good. I don't know what the other.
Thanks a lot, Peter, for this deep dive into the broad.
No, there was only a small dive.
Okay.
About every subject you can talk for hours even.
Then I would be curious to see the deep dive into your.
Well, many people asked me to write a book about it because to keep the experiences